Hello everyone, welcome to another video by Food Emmy. In today's video, we'll be discussing the GATE Solutions 2020. So let's get started. To begin with, let's start with question number one. So the question number one says that the enzyme majorly involved in the post-mortem degradation of muscle protein is, and the given four options are trypsin, calpain, transglutaminase and pepsin. So before understanding the solution of the question, let us basically understand what happens during the post-mortem and how degradation of the muscle protein takes place. So initially, once the animal is slaughtered, it undergoes rigor mortis. So basically what happens is the linkages between the actin and the myosin muscle proteins are formed, and when these linkages form, the muscle basically contracts. Now for the muscle to relax, these linkages need to break. Now for the breakage of these, we require ATP. Now what happens once the animal is slaughtered? Slowly and slowly the ATP supply starts to go down. As a result, anaerobic respiration starts to take place. So once the ATP becomes unavailable, the actin and the myosin linkages which have been formed during the contraction are not able to break. As a result of these linkages, the muscle toughens during the rigor mortis, and if the meat is cooked at this stage, it is tough. So in order to deal with this problem, we have something known as aging or ripening. So as the name is telling, giving some time for the meat. So during the slaughter, if animal has a pH of around 6.8 to 7.3, which drops during the rigor mortis state to 5.4 to 5.8. Now because of this drop in the pH, certain proteolytic enzymes get activated. Now as the name tells, proteolytic enzymes will help to break down these protein linkages, actin myosin linkages which were formed, which were not able to break due to the absence of ATP, will be able to break with the help of proteolytic enzymes which will be inactivated because of the decrease in the pH during the rigor mortis. Now this helps to deal with the problem of rigor mortis and the meat becomes somewhat tender. So this is basically how the post-mortem degradation takes place. So we need to look for the answer. We need to look for an appropriate proteolytic enzyme which is acting in the muscle protein. So the first enzyme we have is calpain. Now calpain is an intracellular calcium dependent neutral proteinase enzyme which is found in almost all eukaryotes and the few bacteria. Now it causes degradation of the myofibrillar proteins, contributing to post-mortem proteolysis and meat tenderization. That means this is the correct answer, because this is the enzyme which is helping in the degradation of the myofibrillar proteins that actin in the myosin linkage which was formed during the post-mortem, and this proteolysis helps in the tenderization of the meat. Therefore, calpain will be the correct answer for the question. Now let us also look at the other options given in the question. So the next enzyme we had was trypsin. So as we all know, trypsin is a protease enzyme present in digestive system which is responsible for breaking down protein into smaller peptides or amino acids. Therefore, trypsin cannot be the correct answer for this question. Next, we have transglutaminase. Transglutaminase is also an enzyme which is found in various tissues and organs, including heart, liver, small intestine, and it catalyzes the formation of isopeptide bond between the proteins and helps in cross-linking of the proteins. So therefore, this will also not be the correct answer. Next, we have pepsin, and we all are very familiar with this enzyme and its role. It splits the protein into water-soluble fragment called as peptones, and it is produced, as we all know, in the lining of the stomach. So therefore, pepsin should also not be the correct answer. So the correct answer for this question will be calpain. That is option number B is the correct answer for this question. Now let us go to the second question. It says, which of the following is a correct pair of essential fatty acid? So we have four options. Each option has two fatty acids, and we have to identify which one of these is a correct pair of essential fatty acids. So first of all, what are essential fatty acids? So as the name tells, essential, they are very essential for our diet. They have to be taken in the diet. That is where the essential comes from. And they are basically unsaturated fatty acids, essential for human health. So if we look at the unsaturated fatty acids, we have basically two fatty acids. We have omega-3. And omega-6. So omega-3 is the alpha-linolenic acid, which we also can write it as ALA. And we have linoleic acid, which we can also call it or write it as LA. So as we can see, Linolenic acid has three double bonds. 18 carbon is the chain length, and for linoleic, 18 is the chain length and two unsaturated bonds. So basically, these are the two essential fatty acids, as we all know, omega 3 and omega 6. Now, if we look at their other forms in which they're present in the body, eicosa pentanoic acid, glucosa hexanoic acid, or we can say EPA and DHA, as we might have heard of them many times before. So basically, they get conjugated to these forms in the body, EPA and DHA, and linoleic acid, which is omega 6, gets converted into arachidonic acid in the body, 22:6. Now, the other options, we have oleic acid and lauric acid given. So oleic acid is basically a MUFA, that is, it has a single double bond and 18 is the carbon chain length, whereas lauric acid is an unsaturated fatty acid. So we know that essential fatty acids are the ones which are essential and unsaturated. So both of these are not the correct answer, because these are saturated and these are non-essential for humans. So that is why the correct option or answer should be linolenic as well as linoleic. So from these options, the correct answer will be linolenic and linoleic. So B option will be correct. In the other options, we have oleic and here lauric, and again oleic is given. So these three will be eliminated and we have the correct answer. Now coming on to the next question, we have question number 3, which says niacin A is produced by, and we have four options: Aspergillus niger, Acetobacter acetate, Lactobacillus lactis and Clostridium perfringens. So let us look at the solution of the question. So firstly, niacin, what is niacin? Niacin is basically an antibiotic like substance, which is also called as bacteriocin. So it is a natural antimicrobial agent which has activity against certain gram-positive bacteria, including food-borne pathogens such as Listeria. So therefore, niacin, we now know, is one of the antibiotic-like a substance which has antimicrobial activity. Now, there are several variants of niacin. So we have niacin A, Z, Q, F, U, as well as U2. So the variants A, Z, Q, F are produced by Lactobacillus lactis, whereas U and U2 are produced by Streptococcus species. So therefore, the correct option for this question should be Lactobacillus lactis. So now let us also look at the other options given in the question. So Aspergillus niger is basically used in the production of citric acid and enzymes. So what we are doing is we're looking at other options and their metabolites, which are given in the other options. So Aspergillus niger helps in the production of citric acid and certain enzymes such as amylase, pectinases and proteinases. Acetobacter acetate is also one of the options given in the question, which is a gram-negative bacteria, and the metabolite which we are obtaining from this is helps in the metabolic production of acetic acid. They also play a role in production of food and beverages such as vinegar, kombucha and many other certain fermented products. Next we have Lactobacillus lactis. Used for the fermentation of food, especially cheese, yogurt, sauerkraut, etc. So that is where the role of Lactobacillus is. Also produces lactic acid. So these are the certain metabolites. It's just lactic acid is obtained from Lactobacillus. We also get diacetyl from Lactobacillus. Then next we have Clostridium perfringens, which is a spore-forming gram-positive bacteria, and it is commonly found on raw meat and poultry. And some strains produce a toxin in the intestine which causes illness. So these are the certain metabolites which are obtained from all of the other options given in the question. So therefore, the correct answer for this is Lactobacillus lactis, which is option number C. Now coming on to question number 4. Which of the following bacteria will stain purple color after gram staining? And we have given four options. So now let us first understand what basically gram staining is. So, Hans Christian Gram has given this particular concept in 1884, and it is a very, very good method to differentiate the certain bacteria into two groups, gram positive and gram negative. Now, gram positive are the ones which have a thick peptidoglycan layer, whereas the gram negative lack this peptidoglycan layer and have a high lipid content instead. Also, gram negative bacteria are more disease causing or more toxic in nature as compared to gram positive bacteria. So gram positive stain purple color on gram staining, whereas gram negative stain red color or pink color on gram staining. So let us look at the steps for gram staining. So firstly, the primary strain is applied. What we basically do, take the microorganism or the sample which is given to us, and primary stain is crystal violet, which shows all the cells purple in color. Now what happens is, the second step is to apply a mordant, that is an iodine, which forms crystal violet iodine. And again, it will help in giving the blue color. The third step is the decolorization, wherein an organic solvent such as acetone or ethanol is being added, which will extract all the dye from the thin-walled gram-negative bacteria. Now, as we discussed, the gram-negative bacteria have no peptidoglycan, a very thin peptidoglycan here, we can say. So this thin wall will not be able to retain the blue color once we are adding a decolorizer. As a result, this step will help us to differentiate gram-positive and gram-negative, wherein the gram-negative bacteria will actually become colorless, but the gram-positive will still retain the blue color of the crystal violet. Now we will add a counter strain. Now, because the gram-negative bacteria was the one which decolorized, it will pick up the counter stain safranin and stain red or pink in color. So the counter stain we apply is safranin, whereas the gram-positive will still be blue in color. That is how we can differentiate them by these four steps. And one very easy way to memorize gram-negative and gram-positive, we have already discussed in one of our older videos as well. So the gram-negatives are actually the one ending with the name Ella. So it is very easy to memorize Salmonella, Shigella, Coxiella, all of these are gram-negative. Other than that, we have certain other also, which we can easily memorize by making some acronym for ourselves. For example, here we can consider HEVPP. So Helicobacter, E. coli, Yersinia, Vibrio, Proteus, Pseudomonas, all these are gram-negative. If we look at the gram-positive ones, we have Streptococci and Staphylococci. So it is very easy to memorize these also, as both of them have a P in them, gram-positive. And the other ones, again, you can make some acronym which helps you memorize them. The one we have made, LVE, love, black. So, lactococci, viridans, enterococci, bacillus, listeria, actinomyces and clostridium, all of these will be gram-positive bacteria. So, now if we go back to the question, we have bacillus subtilis, E. coli, pseudomonas, yersinia. So, we have just looked that yersinia, pseudomonas, E. coli, all of these are gram-negative. And it has been asked which bacteria will stain purple or blue. So, the gram-positive bacteria should be the correct answer. And we have just memorized that bacillus is a gram-positive bacteria. So the correct answer for this question will be answer number A, that is bacillus subtilis. Now we have question number 5. The enzyme system used for removal of glucose from egg white prior to its drying consists of, and we have 4 options. So in order to find out the solution, let us first look at why glucose is being removed from the egg during the drying. So egg contains around 0.4% glucose, which may lead to unwanted browning, and it is a sign of poor quality. So as a result, it might decrease the selling point for the egg, as they will appear somewhat brown in color. That is very, very undesirable. So we want to remove this glucose to avoid that browning problem. So there are 2 types of process for the same. One is fermentation using a bacteria or yeast, or one is enzyme system utilizing glucose oxidase. So first let us look at the fermentation process. So the glucose will basically be converted to alcohol and CO2, as these are both volatile elements. They will escape during the drying. And again, during the fermentation, we have to make sure of certain points, that whatever stain of the bacteria or the yeast we are utilizing, it should be free from any proteolytic enzyme. Otherwise, we know that egg contains a lot of protein, and that protein can be digested. So we do not want that. So it should be free from proteolytic enzyme. And it can also lead to the problem of acidification of the egg mass. That is why, other than fermentation, we prefer the other method, which is the enzyme system method, on a commercial or industrial level. So it is a faster and easier to control method. The temperature utilized is 2 degree to 15 degree, which also helps in avoiding bacterial growth. As we know, microorganisms need around ambient temperature to grow. So the enzyme which we are utilizing is glucose oxidase, which is actually obtained from Aspergillus niger and Penicillium. So what this enzyme basically helps in doing, converts beta glucose to glucanolactone, using oxygen and releasing hydrogen peroxide. So if you look at the reaction, glucose oxidase combines with glucose and FAD, that is flavin adenine dinucleotide, which is a coenzyme, is also utilized. So all three of them will help in forming D-glucanolactone. So the main motive is to remove the glucose. So the glucose is converted into some other form. So the glucose becomes unavailable and this FAD is oxidized to FADH2, which will combine with oxygen to form hydrogen peroxide, as we just discussed. Now there is a problem that if higher concentration of hydrogen peroxide forms, it can lead to oxidation and degrade the protein molecules. And another problem is it will inhibit further enzymatic oxidation of glucose. Therefore, we need to solve this problem of production of H2O2. So what we will do is we need another element to help us. So we will utilize catalase, which will combine with the glucose oxidase. We will combine it with the catalase. What will happen is it will help in converting the hydrogen peroxide to water and oxygen. This will also help in one additional advantage will be that this free oxygen which is formed will be available to oxidize the remaining glucose to glucanolactone. Therefore, if we look at the options, the correct answer for this question should be glucose oxidase and catalase. So option number A will be the correct answer for this question. Now coming on to the next question, which is question number 6, we have the incorrect pair of foodborne illness and its causative microorganism is. So we have 4 different pairs and we have a disease over here and a microorganism over here, and we have to tell which one is the incorrect one. So now let us look at these one by one. So first one we have is the brucellosis. So brucellosis is a see, all of these which are given in the question are basically bacterial infections and bacterial diseases basically. Brucellosis is bacterial disease which is caused by Brucella species. So it is very, very easy to memorize. Brucellosis is happening due to organism known as Brucella. So it is known to infect cattle, swine, goat, sheep and dogs, and direct contact with animal consumption of contaminated products can lead to the transfer of this disease to humans. So humans will only get affected if we are in direct contact with some infected animal or we are consuming some product, for example cheese, milk, which is contaminated or coming from this particular animal which is infected from brucellosis. Next disease we have is the bubonic plague. So bubonic plague, as we know, it is caused by the Yersinia pestis. As we have just looked in the previous question, this Yersinia is a gram-negative species and it is a disease-causing one. So it is responsible for causing bubonic plague. And in this particular disease, a person might suffer from swollen or painful lymph nodes. Generally, the point where the bacteria enters in the body, this lymph node becomes swollen and painful. Next, we have Q fever. We are already very well aware that Q fever is caused due to Coxsilla burnetii. And we also know that Coxsilla burnetii is an index microorganism for the pasteurization of milk. So we already have good information about Coxsilla burnetii. Next, we have peptic ulcers. So peptic ulcers in this particular disease, sores develop in the lining of stomach, lower esophagus or small intestine. It is caused by Helicobacter pylori. We have already looked at this name also when we were looking at the gram-negative certain bacteria. So Helicobacter pylori is again a gram-negative one. And B. subtilis, which is given in the question with the peptic ulcers, is actually a gram-positive and a non-pathogenic one. And the strains of B. subtilis are actually used in the treatment of peptic ulcers. Therefore, if we look at the options, peptic ulcer is matched with Bacillus subtilis, which is actually used in its treatment, and it is caused due to the Helicobacter pylori. Therefore, the wrong answer is peptic ulcer. That is the one which is incorrect pair. So therefore, the correct answer for this question is B. If we look at all others, brucellosis, brucella, bubonic plague, Yersinia, Q fever, Coxsilla burnetii, all three are correct. This is the incorrect matched one, and hence that is the correct answer for our question. Heading on to the next question, which is question number 7, we have which of the following is used as a preservative in tomato sauce? Sodium sulfate, potassium sorbate, potassium sulfate or sodium benzoate. So if you look at these, so basically sodium sulfate and potassium sulfate, they both find use as an acidity regulator in certain foods, and potassium sorbate is basically used to prevent yeast, mold and microbes. So generally, the foods with high amount of moisture, or maybe we can say intermediate moisture foods like cakes, icing, beverage syrup, cheese, wine, margarine, all of these products where we have high chances of yeast, mold and microbe growth, we're utilizing potassium sorbate. So, and then last option, we have sodium benzoate. Now, sodium benzoate, basically it gets converted into benzoic acid and it acts as a preservative, and it is generally used in acidic foods. So acidic foods, if we look at, we have carbonated beverages, jam, pickle, ketchup, sauce, all of these. So therefore, the correct answer from the given options should be sodium benzoate, which is actually used for acidic food products. Therefore, option number D is the correct answer for question number 7. Next, we have question number 10. So question number 10 says, match the protein in the column 1 with its food source in column 2. So here we have certain food sources, zine, gluten, glycerin, ovalbumin, and here we have the food sources, soybean, maize, egg and wheat, and we have to match which one is obtained from which one. So looking at the first one, maize. So maize, actually endosperm contains around 90% starch and 10% protein. Of this 10% proteins, we have albumin, globulin, zine and gluten, and out of which zine is present 50 to 70% in proportion. Therefore, zine is the one which is present in highest quantity in corn, or is the principal protein in the maize. This can be very easily remembered. The scientific name of maize is zea maize, and the principal protein is zine, which are very, very easy to memorize if you remember like this. Now, we have wheat. So, wheat, as we all know, is a source of protein. It contains 8 to 14% protein, and the proteins can be divided into two groups, the non-gluten ones and the gluten proteins. So from the non-gluten ones, we have albumin and globulin. And among the gluten proteins, we know we have gliadin and glutenin. Now the gluten protein form around 75 to around 80% of the total proteins, whereas the non-gluten proteins, they form around 20 to 25% of the non-gluten proteins. Therefore, the major protein which is found in the wheat are the gliadin and the glutenin, which we know on mixing and on hydration form the protein gluten, which is responsible for the good texture or the typical texture in the baked products like cakes, biscuits, all of these. So the correct answer for the wheat should be gluten. Next, we have egg. So egg, as we know, is a very good source of protein and contains lot of protein, ovalbumin, ovotransferrin, ovomucoid, also contains flavoprotein. So ovalbumin is present 54%, followed by ovotransferrin 12% and ovomucoid 11%. So the principal protein present in egg is ovalbumin, which should be the correct answer. And in soybean, the proteins of interest are glycerin and beta corn glycerin, and of these, glycerin is the one which is present in the major quantity. So glycerin should be the correct answer. So if we look at this, zine should go with maize, egg should go with ovalbumin, glycerin with soybean, and gluten obviously with wheat. So the correct option is option number D. That's the correct answer for this question. Again, next question, we have a match the following question. Match the carbohydrates in the column 1. So we have certain carbohydrates with the corresponding enzyme used. So we have the name of enzyme and we have the certain carbohydrates. So what are the carbohydrates these particular enzymes act on? So let us look at these enzymes one by one. So first one, we have polygalacturonase. So polygalacturonase, as the name is telling, see, the name of the enzymes actually help in understanding their meaning a lot. So polygalacturonase will be acting on the galacturonic sugar. So as we know, pectin is something which is made of the galacturonic units. Therefore, it is a pectinase enzyme which will help in breaking the O-glycyl bonds in the pectin's polygalacturonyl network, and it will help in breaking it into alpha-1-4 polygalacturonic residues. Therefore, polygalacturonase will be acting on pectin because it acts on the galacturon sugar. Next, we have beta-galactosidase. Beta-galactosidase is also called lactase, and here we know the meaning. Lactase enzyme will be the one which will act on lactose sugar. So it will catalyze the beta-galactosides in the monosaccharides through breaking the glycosidic bond. It will break the glycosidic bond where the galactose unit is present, as in case of we have, in case of lactose, as we know, we have one galactose unit and one glucose units which are attached together, and this galactose beta glycosidic bond will be broken down with the help of this beta galactosidase. So this enzyme is present in the body, which helps us digest the milk and the milk products, or certain other products which we are eating, which consumes lactose. And this is again very important for the food industry, for utilizing lactose free milk and other dairy products for people who are lactose intolerant. Next we have beta fructofuranosidase. Now inulin is one of the polysaccharide which is present in tuber, root, leaves of many plants, and it consists of chains of beta 2-1 linked with D-fructofuranose. So since inulin consists of fructofuranose linkages, this name, as the name is telling again, it will help in breaking the inulin. Therefore this particular enzyme will be acting on inulin. Next we have xylanase, and again the name is telling, xylanase will be any class of enzyme which are degrading the polysaccharide xylane into xylose. Therefore on hemicellulose it will be acting. So majorly where xylanase enzyme finds a role in the microorganism which want to break down the plants, as we know hemicellulose and xylose, these are majorly present in plants, to degrade them, to break these down and convert it into usable nutrients. Also used in food as a food additive in poultry, wheat flour for improving dough handling, quality for baked foods, and extraction of coffee plant oil and starch from certain plant-based sources. That is where we are utilizing this enzyme. So these are certain other important enzymes and their applications. Alpha amylase, protease, lactase, lipase, pectinase, and there are certain uses in the food industry. For example, pectinase is used in clarification of fruit juices. All of this is some of the other important enzymes with their applications which might be helpful for the GATE exam. So the correct answer for this question should be option number A, that is pectin will go with polygalacturonose, and then lactose will go with galactosidase, hemicellulose would go with xylanase, and inulin will go with beta fructofuranosidase. Therefore that is A is the correct option. Now heading on to the last question, we have match the edible oil refining stage in column 1 with its purpose in column 2. So here we have been giving the refining steps of oil. So as we know, from the oil seeds, the oil is extracted using either mechanical or solvent extraction method. Now this oil is the crude oil which has to undergo refining so that it can be converted into edible oil. So for that refining, if we look at the flow chart, so crude oil which we have obtained from extraction will undergo degumming, deacidification, decolorization, deodorization, winterization, and then we will get edible oil. During the degumming, as the name is telling, removal of certain gums. So we will add water and phosphoric acid, and the gums will be hydrated and they will be removed. So this step will remove gum, lecithin, phospholipids, all the sources of all these gums will be removed. Next step, deacidification, as the name is telling, removal of acid, or we can also call this step as neutralization. So what will happen? NaOH is basically added. See, we have to neutralize the acid, the free fatty acid. So we will be utilizing a base in this step. So free fatty acids will be removed in this step. And then next step is decolorizing, or we can also call this step as bleaching, wherein, as the name is telling, removal of the coloring substances, removal of the acidic substances. So for the decolorization, activated clay is used, and obviously what activated clay will do, it will adsorb all of the coloring particles present. So what are the coloring particles? Basically we are getting the oil from the plant-based sources. So generally the carotenoids are present, giving the off color or the darker color to the oil which is not desirable. So we remove this. Next we have deodorization, as the name tells, removal of odor. So odor giving compounds are the small aldehydes or ketones which are present in the oil. They are all volatile compounds, and so in order to remove them, if we subject it to direct steam at a high temperature, these compounds will be volatile. So aldehyde, ketones, etc. will be removed at this step. And last is the winterization, which we may or may not do, where we store the oil at a lower temperature, let's say around 5-4 degrees Celsius. And what happens is all the triglycerides or the triacylglycerides, they solidify, and thereby they can be removed by filtration to prevent the solidification of oil at room temperature. Therefore, these are the products which are being removed at each step and what is being added in order to remove them at each step. So if now we know the refining process, so if you look at the option, the correct answer is option number D, that is degumming helps in the separation of the phosphatides. Neutralization helps in the removal of the free fatty acids. Bleaching helps in the removal of the pigments. And winterization helps in the separation of the triglycerides. Therefore, the correct answer is option number D. With this, we end this video. We hope that this video was helpful for your GATE preparation. Do not forget to like and share the video as it might be helpful for many GATE aspirants out there. Also, do not forget to subscribe to our channel for many more upcoming videos from Food Evie. Thank you for watching.